Friends, thank you all very much indeed for attending this morning. I know it's a wonderful day, and this is a more powerful reason, though, for you being out of the sun and being in here, because it's about the election for the next leader of the Labour Party. For those of you that don't know me, I'm Bill Townsend. I'm the chair of Coventry North West CLP and the deputy leader of the Labour group on the council. We've endeavoured to try very hard to get all of the candidates for the Labour leadership up to Coventry, because this is a city with three Labour MPs and with a large Labour majority on the City Council, so it's important that we should have the debate. I want to say this, I want to thank Jeremy Corbyn for having come up, I want to thank Andy Burnham for coming up, and of course today I want to thank Yvette especially for coming up. And I want to ask that we have an interesting and challenging debate. There'll be an opportunity, obviously, for Yvette to set out her stall for you, and then for you to be able to ask questions of her. I ask that we do it in a comradely way, because I think that's really important, that we keep this about policy and not about personalities. And I want to thank Geoffrey Robinson, the Member of Parliament for Coventry North West, for being here today. And I also want to thank Jim Cunningham, who's going to chair the meeting, who's the Member of Parliament for Coventry South. Yvette Cooper is a Member of Parliament for Normanton, Pontefract and Castleford since 2010, and she served in the Cabinet between 2008 and 2010 under Gordon Brown, was Chief Secretary to the Treasury and then as Secretary of State for Work and Pensions. And in 2010 she was initially Shadow Foreign Secretary and latterly has served on a very high profile level and very robustly as Shadow Home Secretary. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a Coventry welcome to the Right Honourable Yvette Cooper.
Thank you very much. Can I just thank you, all of you, so much for coming today, because especially when we've got such fantastic weather outside and glorious sunshine as well. We've had a whole series of, I think, really good hustings, debates, meetings, all over the country. Yesterday I was in Plymouth and in Bristol. Tomorrow I'll be in Leicester. We're all over the country. And also, I think, some really good debates between the four candidates as well. And look, of course, there are, you know, robust debates about particular policy issues, and so there should be, because there's a lot at stake. This is about the future of the Labour Party. Actually, more importantly, it's about the future of the country as well. So, of course, we're going to have those robust debates. But actually, the debates have also been between the four of us, very friendly as well. And I think not about personality, and it is really important, but it's not about the personality. It is about the kinds of issues and the ideas for the future. And so our hustings have always been, in fact, very good-humoured, and so much so that you'll have seen, I think somebody was criticising us for actually being too friendly almost in them. You'll have seen the picture that they've used in a lot of, the Guardian website uses it all the time, and a lot of the others, of the four of us standing together, you know, arms round each other, all beaming for the cameras. And we actually had, as we came off after, I think it was the Nuneaton hustings, and we came off afterwards, and I could hear there was a woman on the phone. I think maybe she was talking to her daughter as we came, as we all four of us filed by. And you could hear her saying something along the lines of, as we thought, it was really good. Yeah, it was really good. So there was a blonde one, and a dark one, and a bearded one, and another one. And you thought, oh my God, they think we're an ABBA tribute band. And that's been, you know, that was the kind of sometimes the nature of the kinds of debates that we had. But look, you know, for all of the good human debates, for all of the good debates that we've had about policy, I'll be really honest with you, I wish I wasn't here in these circumstances today, because I wish we'd won. You know, I wish I'd been here as Labour Home Secretary, here to talk to you about how we were going to get more neighbourhood police back on the streets of Coventry. You know, talking about how we would have a new violence against women and girls bill to deal with the fact that two women a week are still killed by a partner or an ex. And we wanted a national refuge fund to stop refuges closing. We wanted new national standards in the way that police respond. We wanted compulsory sex and relationship education in schools to teach zero tolerance of violence among teenagers. We wanted so many things to do, and we can't. And what brought it home to me was actually was polling day itself. And any of you who've been to the West Midlands hustings, I told this story at the hustings because it really struck me at the time, was in my constituency when we were knocking on doors in Normanton, and a woman came up to me and said, and she was in tears when she approached me, and to ask for my help because she had over £1,000 arrears in the bedroom tax. So I said, look, of course I would help her, but really she should go vote today because, you know, we were obviously campaigning to get rid of the bedroom tax altogether. So she did. She went out to vote, wouldn't normally vote, she went out to vote. She voted Labour, she voted for me, she voted for all of us. But the truth is, because we lost, that bedroom tax is still in place. And that means her arrears are still in place. And I feel like we let her down. Because yeah, we won in Normanton, but we lost in Nuneaton. We won in some of our constituencies, we won here in Coventry, we did well in the big cities, but in so many of the suburbs, the towns, the coastal towns, we lost where we wanted to win. And that means there's an awful lot of people who really depend on the Labour government, who I do feel we've let down, and we must not let them down again. And that's why I'm standing. Because I think we have got to be radical with our vision of the future, we've got to be proud of our Labour values, we've not got to swallow the Tory myths, we've got to be strong enough to stand up against them, but we've also got to be strong enough to reach out, and on behalf of all of those people who need a Labour government, we've got to make sure that we can win. So when you've got your ballot paper in front of you, make sure you're thinking not just about who can be the leader of the opposition right now, but also who can be strong enough to take them on and who can make sure we can get a Labour government in future. And I think that does mean, I want to talk a bit about values and what that means to me, about what I think it means in terms of holding the Tories to account, what I think it means in terms of the ideas for the future, and then also how we reach out. For me, we all have different reasons as to why we're Labour, what's made us Labour in the first place. For me, it was my family are from the coalfield communities. My granddad was a miner, my dad a trade unionist, and I learned early that sense of solidarity, that we are stronger when we stand together than when we leave each other to sink or swim alone. That faith in working hard, in education as a way to get on, but also in making sure other people can get on as well, and never leaving anybody behind, and looking out for your neighbour as well as for your family. And I learned too, I think, the other strand that's been important to me and my values is the radical equality tradition. It goes back to Labour's campaigns with the suffragettes, through the liberation and emancipation movements. It's why one of the first campaigns I was involved in as a teenager was against Section 28. And why too, I was proud to be Labour's leading campaigner for equal marriage in the last few years, because I think that is about a deep respect and equality of every single human being, whatever their background, whatever their circumstances, and also challenging the prejudice and poverty which still hold too many people back. And it's why I hate what the Tories are doing to Britain. Hate the fact that half the world's wealth is held in the hands of just 1% of the world's population. That is unjust, it's unfair, it's wrong, and Labour should be campaigning against it. And in order to do that, we've got to be strong enough to take the Tories on. And that means not swallowing their myths, particularly their myths about us. And let's be very clear, look, it wasn't the deficit that caused the financial crisis, it was the financial crisis that caused the deficit, and it wasn't too many teachers, too many nurses, too many sure starts that caused Lehman Brothers Bank in New York to crash, and we should never let anyone get away with saying that. And look, this has been a big difference between us as part of the hustings and as part of the campaign and the debate, because, you know, we've had debates, particularly Andy and I, about the last Labour government and what was happening with spending, what was happening with the small deficit that we had at the time. And I am just really clear, that small deficit that we had at the time, because we'd paid down so much debt before that, didn't make us too weak to support the economy when the financial crisis happened. It certainly didn't cause the deficit, sorry, it didn't cause the financial crisis, but it also didn't make us too weak to respond. Because actually, as you know, here in the West Midlands, we were strong enough to have the Future Jobs Fund to stop youth unemployment soaring. We were strong enough to have the car scrappage scheme that stopped our car industry going bust in the middle of the financial crisis. And we were strong enough to stop the banks crashing with our hopes and our dreams. And so, you know, Andy and I have disagreed about this, but I don't think it is right to apologise for Labour's public spending, I will not apologise for the investment that we put into our hospitals and into our sure starts. It didn't cause the financial crisis. What it did was it delivered the public services that we need and we depend on. And we've got to also be confident enough and strong enough to take the Tories on in Parliament, to take David Cameron on in Parliament, which frankly I would relish. Strong enough too to stand up against them on the welfare reform bill. And let's be honest, that's been a mess. And we had, in fact, there were two votes on the welfare reform bill. The first vote was a vote against the welfare reform bill. But, and it would have stopped it completely, but that's got completely lost on the second vote, which was, frankly, a messy compromise in order to hold the parliamentary party together, and it failed to even do that. And it didn't work. And we should just be clear and simple. Let's not try to be clever about this. Let's be clear and simple. That welfare reform bill includes a series of things, including getting rid of the child poverty targets. It includes what I call the children tax, which is saying that families with three kids somehow would end up worse off in work just because they've got three kids rather than two. I don't think that is right. It includes a series of things that mean if those things aren't taken back and taken out of the bill, when that bill comes back before Parliament, we will, if I am elected, we will, as leader, we will oppose it. Pure and simple, we should oppose it and be strong enough to stand up for what we believe in. And we've also got to have our ideas for the future. The radical vision that we believe in, that the Labour Party believes in and stands up for. So I think that does mean standing against George Osborne's 40% cuts to public services. That's what he wants to do. Now, that has got nothing to do with bringing the deficit down. That's not about bringing borrowing down. That goes way further than anything you need to do. That it is about an ideology of austerity. It's about, because the Tories don't believe in our public services, they're using their economic lines as an excuse to shrink the state and to have this ideological assault on public services because they don't believe in them. We can have the confidence to stand against that 40% cuts to our public services and to oppose them. But here's the difference between Jeremy and I on this one, which we again have had discussions about as part of the hustings. I don't think it's right to oppose them by thinking you just print money. That's not going to work. And all that will do is push up inflation. All that will do is actually make all of us worse off. Year after year, you can't just print money to pay for things that you can't afford. I think instead, the way we do it is we grow our economy. And let's grow our economy with going for jobs of the future. So we know here in the West Midlands, we have a great, proud manufacturing tradition. But where are the good jobs of the future coming from? If you're lucky enough for kids to get a good new job, brilliant. You get on, fantastic. But too many of our young people, the only jobs they're able to apply for are low-skilled, low-paid. Our economy is relying too much on cheap labour. So why don't we double our investment in science for the future? That's what Germany's done. It's what other countries have done. That could deliver us 2 million more high-tech, high-skilled manufacturing jobs. With the Midlands championing those kinds of jobs for the future, that is how I think we have an alternative economic policy that is much stronger than what George Osborne says, but also much fairer too. And as part of that, we've got to get over this divide, this vocational and academic divide, which is just British snobbery, that treats academic education on the one hand, vocational education as second class. It's wrong. It's letting our children down, but it's also holding our economy back. We, the Labour Party, have to stand up and change that. And there's so many other things we should do. We want a fairer country. And that means campaigning for a full living wage, not just George Osborne. It's great, look, George Osborne is increasing the minimum wage. Great, it's our campaign, we called for it, but it's not a living wage. So why don't we start by leading the campaign for a living wage in that area which is so important, where so many people end up being not just underpaid, but actually exploited, but where the service being provided is also undervalued. I'm talking about the area where our elderly and those who are vulnerable need care. So why don't we start by paying 1.4 million people in social care a full living wage, close the tax loopholes on the Eurobonds and the hedge funds. In order to do it, we can start, Labour can start by paying a full living wage, not just a minimum wage, a full living wage in social care, and start valuing social care for a change. So many more things we could do. Free universal childcare. because actually that's as important now as roads and railways and supporting our economy. We could do that by married couples' tax break that only goes to a small minority of families and actually stigmatises single parents and other families. Put that money into extending free childcare so that you actually support our economy and stop parents being stretched and strained. So many things that we could do for build more homes, the new homes of the future, more council homes, more affordable homes, and properly put the attempt to get end child poverty in a generation back at the heart of what we do. So I think we can do all of those things. And that's not about going back to Clause 4. It's about the radical ideas of the future. It's not about just printing money. It's about strong, real things that could deliver us the real jobs and the real public services that we need. It's not about swallowing Tory myths, but it's not about standing on the sidelines either. And that's going to be the crunch as well. Because in order to do any of these things, we've got to be able to win. In order to do any of these things, we've got to stay an internationalist party, not pull out of the EU, not shrink and look inwards on ourselves, but be a strong, outward-looking party and strong with our approach, reach out across the country. I was born in Scotland, brought up in England. My family from the north, I actually went to a comprehensive in the south. My first job was about as rural as it gets, working on a farm, driving a tractor, strangely enough. And my kids now go to school in the big city, and I love the diversity of Britain. But it's got to make us stronger, not be something that pulls us apart. We're going to need a Prime Minister, as well as a Labour leader, who can be as at home on the business boardroom as the school gate, as at home in the working men's clubs as the pensioners' tea, to be able to reach out to build the support so that we, the Labour Party, can get back into government to do any of these things. Because otherwise, we're just a party of protest standing on the sidelines. Otherwise, we're letting people down. And I know a lot of people have said as part of this, you've got to choose between your head and your heart. You've got to choose between your principles and power. We're the Labour Party. We can't do that. Our whole purpose, when from very being founded, was to say we want to put our principles into practice. We want to not just be angry at the world. We, the Labour Party, want to change the world. We can't do that if we leave power in the hands of a narrow Tory elite. We can't do that if we turn our backs on the next election. Because anybody who says to you, well, it's only the principles that matter and it doesn't matter about winning elections, well, tell that to my constituent who's still got her £1,000 arrears in bedroom tax. Tell that to the parents who are just losing their tax credits and are worried about whether or not they can buy their school shoes for this autumn. Tell that to all the people who depend on a Labour government. Because if we're not standing up for them, nobody else is going to. And if we're not changing the law to help them, nobody else is going to. And if we're not, the Labour Party, standing together, loud and proud as we have always been, to change Britain, to get a fairer, more just, stronger country, no one else is going to do it. I'm only here today because for 100 years, the Labour Party, the Labour movement, and Labour governments have been campaigning for women's equality. Things that Labour governments have done, on the Equal Pay Act, on so many things, childcare, so many things that Labour governments have done that made it possible. But I do worry about my children, about all of our children and grandchildren, because you see David Cameron turning the clock back. You see women being hit harder than men, widening inequalities. We know David Cameron has a woman problem. So why don't we give him an even bigger one and elect our first Labour woman leader and our first Labour woman Prime Minister as well. Thank you.
Thanks, Yvette. Now, I've got the nasty part, for want of a better term, because Yvette's got to be out of here about round about 1 o'clock, as I understand it. She's got heavy commitments to the West Midlands. Pardon?
Can't hear you.
Right, I've got the worst job, part of the job to do. Yvette has got to be out of here by 1 o'clock. She's got other commitments in the West Midlands. And can I welcome Jack Dromey and Shabina Hamid at the back there? They've been sitting very quietly listening to what Yvette has got to say. Now, is there any questions? And I'll take them in batches of threes. The lady at the back there, and then Ram, and then you. Okay, at the back. Yeah.
When you were in the Home Office, I was in the Army. I served during the Falklands War, I served during the Iraq War. I then worked for 16 years as a nurse in the NHS. I had a road accident, which wasn't my fault, and ended up being disabled. benefits grounds, you're no wonder you support Labour. And I want the Labour Party to show the British public that the Conservatives only run one for two reasons. One, because they're hammering us on the economy, and we're not bad economists either. And two, they label us as the nanny party. And what you're saying about the living wage, I wholeheartedly agree with. We don't need to increase social benefits, we need to lift people out so they don't need the benefits that the Labour Party provided.
Run.
Thank you. I'm just going to be sharp and I'm going to ask the same question which I asked two other candidates. Otherwise, it'll be unfair for me to ask a different one. I came up born in slums back in India, which is called untouchable community. That's why I joined the Labour Party, because this was the only party which was talking about equality other than the Communist Party. So I'm working on this since a long time. You may be aware of the campaign which was left somewhere a little bit during the Equality Act, because I personally did lobby Harriet Harman when she came here once at that time. But that issue is left behind, that should be on the statute book by the minister, whoever coming. Somehow, if that's a weakness of the Act. People like me, they don't...
Which bit of the Act?
The Equality Act.
Yeah.
There's an issue of the caste
issue, yes.
Which was, they said it was a proven case at that time. Now the report is out, it's proven case.
Yeah.
And it's put for the consultation. I think it's being pushed in the back grass by even some of the Labour MPs. I'm not saying every Labour MP. Most of them sitting in the comfort zone. None of the MPs from Asian community who are there, either Tory or Labour, suffered the problems which I suffered. I agree with your point. It's not being angry. It's issue of working to change the world. What would you do to change that word for me on that case?
Before I take the next question here, can you keep them as short as possible? Because I want to try and get as many people in as I can.
Welcome to Coventry, Yvette. I'm Fadel Tekruri. My question to you about the foreign policy over the last, conservative liberal government, the marked failure of foreign policy, and I think our foreign policy is still a failure. What's your view of the world? And how would you conduct yourself in government that would make this world a little bit more fair and would reduce the pressure? I just came back from Africa and I met a university professor, a head of a department. His average income is $400 a month. An ordinary employee in Sudan earns about $1 a day. With this sort of pressure on people living just a couple of thousand miles away from us, and with the modern communication technology that show them how we live here and how they live there, the world will continue to be a more dangerous place. How would you lead a Labour Party and a Labour government, hopefully, to make this world more just and more equal?
Yeah. They're really good questions. Sorry, what was your name? I missed your name at the beginning.
Christine.
Thank you for your question, Richard. I think I think you're right. There's been a lot of actually really divisive demonising by the Tories. You've seen disability hate crimes rise, and something really appalling to see in the 21st century. I also think we've got to have respect for people, whatever their circumstances and backgrounds. And I'd say part of this, 20 years ago, I was ill for 12 months and unable to work, and hated every minute of it, was desperate to get back to work, but couldn't because I was too sick. And I had to claim benefits during that year. I would never have expected that to happen to me, but it did. And you never know what's going to come around the corner. You never know what's going to hit you. You never know who's going to be next for whatever it is that life's going to throw at you. And sometimes in your life, you do need the support of others. You do need the support of the whole community. And that's something we should be proud of. And that's why I will never, ever describe people as benefit scroungers or welfare cheats. I just think it is wrong. We shouldn't do it. We shouldn't pander to the right-wing debate about this, and we should be confident about our values. So we can have, our values can be about responsibility, about working hard, about supporting work and supporting jobs, and at the same time, keeping a respect for people as part of that. And the other thing I think is that what the Tories do is they think things like tax credits or, you know, all that sort of thing is a bad thing because it makes people dependent. What we know is it gives people independence. If you've got your mobility, that is what gives you your independence, then maybe you'll be able to go to work. If it's your tax credits, it's what gives you the independence to be able to pay your childcare so you can go to work. If it's social care, it's the same with public services. It'll give you the independence to stay in your own home rather than go into an institution. So many times it's a fundamental difference between us. They think it's about dependency and it's a bad thing. We think it's about independence and opportunity and empowering everybody and respecting everybody. Fundamental difference between us, and that is why in the end the Tories will never stand up for working people across Britain, will never stand up for the communities that we, the Labour Party, have to defend. Your question about caste discrimination, I've actually been involved in some of these debates in Parliament and pressing the government to do more on this, pressing them with amendments that we had in the House of Lords. Any kind of discrimination is wrong. And we, the Labour Party, have to stand against discrimination, be it about caste discrimination, be it about race discrimination, be it about disability discrimination. We, the Labour Party, believe in that equality of respect. So I have been actually pushing them to do more on this and to bring in the consultations and so on, and will continue to do so because I do think it is about equality and about respect. On the foreign policy issue and how, what approach would you take to foreign policy? I think we have to maintain our values as an internationalist party. What the David Cameron approach has, I think, been the pulling back from Europe, for example, pulling back from engagement. If you look at what's been happening in Europe, if you look at the way in which Greece has been treated by Northern European countries, it is completely unsustainable. And Greece is going to end up unable to pay its debts because it hasn't got growth. And the deal that the Northern European countries, led by Germany in the Eurozone, keep enforcing on Greece is just not going to work. It's not the right approach at all. It is a kind of narrow austerity approach. But what's Britain doing in this debate? Just absent. We ought to have an active British government that's being a broker and getting a deal that actually works for Greece, for the whole of the Eurozone, actually for the whole of Europe. And so that's what I mean about I think we should have an active, engaged debate as part of international organisations through the EU, through NATO. I don't think we should be talking about withdrawing from NATO. I don't think we should be talking about not being part of proper UN debates. We should be proud of our internationalist reputation and be active in doing so. We've got to accept that things in our foreign policy have gone badly wrong in the past. And I think we had made the wrong decision around Iraq, for example. There were no weapons of mass destruction and there wasn't proper planning in the aftermath. But we also made the right decision, I think, about Kosovo and about preventing genocide in Europe. And we were right to engage on that. So I think we can have a positive internationalism in our party rather than shrink ourselves back in and rather than do what the Tories are doing, which is to isolate ourselves from all of the European partners, whether we're dealing with extremism, whether we're dealing with jobs and trade, whether we're dealing with the humanitarian crisis from Syria and migration across Europe in so many different ways. We can only respond if we work together. I think that's about Labour principles, that working together in partnership rather than shrinking our horns in and looking inwards and being too narrow and too dark a country.
Yeah, go on.
Yes, you have to have the best barons on your side. It's a general election. People like Murdoch. You got Tony Blair in three times. The influence of the press at an election is vast. You can't underrate those people. If you're not on their side, you don't win. Because the influence of the press barons is immense. Because without the people, unless you're centre ground, you don't get anywhere. They hate the left. Thank you very much.
Gentleman in the pink shirt, yeah.
Yeah. I'm Richard. A couple of things. The first one is just one word and a question mark, trident. The second one is, for me to decide who I'm going to vote for, I need to know what their views are on Israel and their relationship with Palestine and the abhorrent behaviour of the Israeli government towards the Palestinians and their continual breaking of international law. And yet Netanyahu is coming here in about 6 months.
take one more. Gentleman at the front there.
Yes, I recently joined the Labour Party.
I
recently joined the Labour Party. I haven't been a part of any political organisation before in my life. I was told 2 days ago that I'm now no longer in the Labour Party. I haven't got a vote in the forthcoming election. Have you got any comments about the efficacy of the voting system and how it's working? Because I would like to be part of a party and engage. I don't know why I've been excluded. I've not been told at all.
Okay. So, first question about the press. I think you're right that there have been different right-wing, sort of press concentrations that have had an impact, but I don't think we can pander to that. And I don't think it's right to pander to anybody. I think we've got to be strong about our values and about what we believe in. I think that Ed Miliband was right to stand up against all the problems with hacking and the immoral behaviour that we saw in the media. I think he was right too to stand up against the way in which they attacked his dad. I mean, just appalling behaviour. We've got a robust media debate in Britain, and we have press freedom, and we have to be part of that debate. And in some ways, having the scrutiny of the media is really important in a democracy. But I think we can be confident about our values and also recognise that this is, nowadays the debate has become so much more democratised. It's not just about what a Labour shadow cabinet member puts in a press release that then gets reported in a small number of national newspapers. The world's moved on completely from that. It's now about social media, about Facebook, about all of us talking to friends, to communities. The debate involves far more of us, and actually, we believe in power being in the hands of the many, not the few. That is an important and valuable thing that we should celebrate, but it does mean there's more responsibility on actually every Labour Party member. It's now part of that debate in a way that actually people weren't if you go back even 5 years ago, and we should make the most of that and see that as a positive thing rather than feeling like what we've got to do is kind of respond to a narrow media debate, which is not in the end about our values, and we've got to be confident enough, I think, to stand up for our values instead. Question about Trident. I've always been a multilateralist, and I was a multilateralist in the 80s when it was unfashionable in the Labour Party. I'm a multilateralist still now, even if it might be unfashionable in the Labour Party, but I've got to be honest with everybody. I think that is the right thing to do. It goes back to those principles about internationalism, that I think in the end you work together with other countries to try and reduce nuclear weapons, to try and reduce the nuclear threat. Actually, interestingly, that's what we did around Iran. And the work that's been done around preventing nuclear power development for Iran is being part of that international debate and that international diplomacy as well. So that is the way I think we should approach it. I understand that, look, if this was all just about seeking votes in the Labour Party, there's some things that it'd be easy to say. But I'm going to be honest, because I've got to be honest with you about what I think is in the interests of both our national security and also internationalism and those principles that I think we should stand up for. In terms of Israel-Palestine, there's a huge... I mean, it just sort of breaks your heart to see the lack of progress, the huge inequalities, the things that we've seen in Gaza, the things that we've seen right across Palestine. We have got to have a two-state solution. And in the end, the peace process has to deliver that two-state solution. But we also have to have as much pressure as we can through what the British government does, but again, those international processes to work towards that two-state solution. That means recognition of Palestine. Also has to mean security for Israel as well. Look, in the last election, for the Labour Party, the idea that Netanyahu would be elected again is obviously hugely disappointing because it has a huge impact on that peace process. But we think the more that we can do to keep believing in that peace process, the better, because if we simply turn our backs on it, all that we'll see is wider problems and wider repercussions across the Middle East for a long time to come. You asked about PR. The problem I think about the PR is that if we have a debate now, if it's like we just lost the election, if we suddenly come back and say actually the answer, Labour's answer, we didn't talk about PR before the election, but suddenly because we lost the election, now we want to talk about PR. I think that's quite a hard argument to make. I think there is a much bigger issue though, about I think we should be looking much wider at constitutional reform. It'd be a really radical approach to constitutional reform. Let's have a big constitutional convention that we were set up even in opposition, but ask other parties to join and be part of, to look at not just the Scottish devolution and Welsh devolution, but much stronger devolution across England as well, to shake up House of Lords. I mean, you can't believe the fact that House of Lords, they are, at the same time that Karen is talking about shrinking the House of Commons for his own party political reasons, he also wants to add another whole load of Tory appointees to the House of Lords, purely about stacking the system. I think there should be a moratorium. I think there's got to be a cap on appointments to the House of Lords until we actually see some progress being made and some proper reforms in place. Personally, I would like us to take the House of Lords, as well as democratising it, take it out of Westminster, take it out of London altogether. I'd like, as a Yorkshire MP, I'd like to see it in Leeds, House of Leeds, rather than House of Lords. But I accept you might want it in Coventry or somewhere else in the West Midlands. We can have a debate and an argument about that. You could look at PR, you could look at different voting systems as part of that constitutional convention, but I don't think it will sort of solve any problems for us to suddenly say this is what we should do right now, straight after the election that we've lost. Now, finally, your point about the system and the vote. You'd be honest, as a candidate, I'm figuring the responsibility on the electoral system has to be with the party, not with the candidates. It would be wrong for the candidates to be engaged in the detailed process of who's voting and who's not voting, because that gets you into all kinds of, you know, difficult territory. The party has to have the sensible, robust processes in place. I did have, we want as many people as possible involved in this election. We've got to have as many, we want people to be joining our party, joining our movement, to be part of us getting a Labour government elected again. Exactly. So I can't, I don't know the circumstances, and I do, you know, do take it up with one of the Coventry MPs. I think it's better to take it up, I think, with you all than through me, because I think it would be probably inappropriate for me as a candidate to be making representations on behalf of individuals. I did have, when I did a Three Counties Radio, which covers Buckinghamshire, Hertfordshire and so on, one of the journalists did say to me he knew three Tory councillors who had signed up in order to vote. And I said, well, please send us their details and we'll pass them on, because clearly what we don't want is people who are, you know, campaigning at the party. Exactly. So of course there's got to be a process of checks in place, but it's also got to be one which is, you know, as fair as possible.
Gentlemen there.
John Lindsay. I used to be an active member of the Labour Party until Tony Blair took over the leadership, and his handling of Clause 4 made me leave the party completely. I wonder how he would justify the demolition of Clause 4 and whether you'd like to see it reinstituted.
The lady there. Yeah. You? Yeah.
Hi. Helen Spence, retired teacher. I'd like to ask you, Yvette, what your view is on returning power to the emasculated local authorities. They've been emasculated by successive governments, but recently it's been education that's been taken out. And I would like to suggest to you that one of the reasons that people are not voting and also deciding to vote for the SNP or UKIP is because they feel completely disenfranchised and that nothing that they say seems to have any effect on what's actually happening. Thank you.
Yeah, so let me answer the Clause 4 one first, because actually the transport one and the local authorities one, actually there's some links in the way I think we need to respond to it. So just start with the Clause 4 question. I mean, I think I don't think we should go back to Clause 4, because I think we've got to have the radical ideas of the 21st century rather than go back to things that we had from the middle of the 20th century. So I think I do think we should have more public control of the railways. And I think that the way in which the railway privatisation took place caused huge problems, and I think there's a lot more you can do there. But I don't want us to go back to the days of British Leyland. I think we should be thinking about the new and digital jobs of the future and not spending billions of pounds that we haven't got on transferring control of big companies from one small group of people in a big company to another small group of people in Whitehall. I don't think actually that is very radical and will give power back to people across the country. To be honest, I think it'd be far more radical to expand SureStart across the country. You know, when you look at the amazing things that SureStart's done, putting hands in the hands of a power in the hands of families and parents to be able to support their kids to get on, to be able to do amazing things for the future. So that's why I think in the end, this is, and or the digital economy. You know, you've got digital startups and new jobs, the digital things. That's what we should be championing for the future, rather than the kind of big just transfers between Whitehall and out of Whitehall and back again, that I don't think will actually help our economy grow and help us get the tackle inequality in the future as well. The question then about transport, transport infrastructure. It's shocking what the Tories have done on this, because they had all of those press opportunities. You saw David Cameron posing with candidates with big promises for the Midland Main Line, big promises for the Trans-Pennine Line, all of these things they were going to do if they won the election. Election comes and then they immediately just shelve them and cancel them. It's a lie, actually, that they campaigned on, is the truth. And so I think the bigger problem here is that you've got some of these transport decisions all being made in Whitehall, that as a result, I think you're probably right, we're not actually getting the priorities in terms of the order of investment. I think it's great to have big infrastructure and big new infrastructure, but if you don't do the connecting infrastructure, if you don't have actually the important commuter lines to all of our smaller cities, then you're not really going to get the progress and the underpinning infrastructure that we need for a modern economy. So what I would do is have much more devolution than the Tories are talking about, to regions, to local areas, to make the decisions about what are the transport priorities, and then also give them the power so that they then don't get ripped up. Because as long as that power is back in Whitehall, you know, you can have all these plans, it gets through before an election, after an election it gets ripped up again. So let's actually devolve that investment back down to local areas, so local areas can decide what is the priority. Is it the big connection? Is it the smaller links? What will make the biggest difference to our communities and to our economy as well? And that, I think, is part of the answer as well to the devolution. Look, we did, originally, Labour did some great stuff on devolution, and then I think it just kind of lost momentum, you know, lost its way. And we have got to be the party that is putting power in the hands of the many, not the few, and that means power that's got to be local, which is your thing. And I think you are right that too many people do feel like power is a long way away. It's not in their hands, it's not in their communities, it's not something they can influence. So I give far more power back to local authorities, go much further than what the Tories are doing. It's interesting as well, because you know, they get Greater Manchester, where they make a big play about Greater Manchester, but they're insisting on them having a mayor, even if actually, well, that should be up for local areas to decide. Some areas want a mayor, that's great, some areas don't, should be for them to decide. And the one thing they are not devolving is education, because that's all being centralised. All of the free schools, all of the academies, it's all centralised now for the Department of Education. And I think that's the right approach. If you're a parent, you're worried about your local school, what do? Ring up Nicky Morgan? I think she's going to be busy. You know? So why don't we just bring power back to local communities, to local councils, proper accountability, the standards in education, proper decisions about how we link education and skills for our young people through apprenticeships, through adult skills, all of those things are linked together. It should be local communities making those decisions about how you properly integrate and how you link it with local businesses so you can work with businesses in the right way. So look, let's be strong and confident about devolution, and let's ask the Labour Party be really the party that is championing properly local devolution, and that also has got to mean fairer resources as well, because if all the Tories do is cut resources by 40% to our local government and then devolve power, actually what they're really doing is devolving blame. So we've got to be campaigning against the 40% cuts as well as campaigning for more devolution to our local communities.
Gentlemen, yeah.
Jamie went first, and I'm Coventry GPs, and inevitably my question is about how. Two things. What would you do to stop the rampant privatisation of the NHS? Something which, to be honest, the Labour Party has been complicit in the past, particularly around the Darcy Centre. And second, what would you do about PFI, which in Coventry is a huge millstone around the health economy and is actually really stopping.
Yeah.
Hi there, I'm Alan Eath. I'm president of the Quarantine Law Society. I'm
And recently I've been helping Coventry Law Centre allow people access to justice who cannot afford it. Only few people can afford representation, the men can't. It's outrageous. We've got Gove now who's going to be taking over the justice system. What can you do to improve access to justice for everyone?
Yeah. My name is Paul McGowan. I'm a constituent of Mr. Cunningham's, as you will testify. Political elites are dangerously complacent, so says Professor Robert Skidelsky of our very own Warwick University. They are, in relation to the big issues, which are attracting people to the Labour Party in huge numbers at the moment. How are you going to retain those people? And what are you going to do about those big issues of defence, disarmament, the arms trade, and the banks?
Okay.
Okay. Yep. So we'll sweep through the NHS, the entire justice system, international policy, defence, disarmament, and then we'll end up with banking. So, and I'll try to do so in as short a period of time as possible. So the health service first. We have my constituency. We've had one of these services where the NHS was required to contract it out as part of the new rules. They then had to give the contract to a private company that came in with the lowest bid. None of us believed that bid was possible with the cheap price that they'd come in on it at. Nobody in the NHS believed it, nobody outside the NHS believed it, but they said they had no choice but to give it to this private company. The service has, as a result, had huge problems. They've not sorted the appointment system out properly. They've had consultants walking away. They've been doing all kinds of dubious things. We had questions raised about whether they were just referring people directly back to the GP in order to get more payments rather than referring them on and properly integrating with acute services. Whole series of problems. And that is because of this framework that the Tories brought in, this requirement for competition, contracting out. We've got to get rid of it. It's deeply damaging to the health service. And it is the wrong principle for a national health service, which has got to be around patients. It's got to be putting patients at the heart of it and services working together in partnership to support patients and keep that principle of partnership working, that principle of being free at the point of need, free when you need it, that we have been so proud of in our national health service for generations. And we have to stand up again for it now. So yeah, I would repeal the NHS bill. I think, look, The PFI system is not perfect. It was a way of getting investment in to get new hospitals built at a time where actually otherwise we would have not seen the new hospitals built. But there are problems with it, and you should always keep the review and see what you can do to deal with the local economies. I don't know, some of the areas I know have had problems where, because what part of what was happening was the plan for the hospital was based on a projection about the rising income for the health service that the Tories then took away. And so as a result, you've then got what's effectively been the cuts to the health service and the squeeze on resources makes it then a huge problem in terms of whether it's dealing with the PFI, whether it's dealing with other great increasing demand for A&E or increasing demand for social care as well. Cannot get away from the fact that our National Health Service does need to be properly supported. And that does take me back to this, why I think I keep going on about this, because actually I don't think people have really appreciated, kind of in the media, have recognised the significance of this. This 40% cuts that George Osborne wants to do is going to be devastating. And, you know, that is 40%, even if they kind of try and exclude the health service from it, social care is going to be hugely hit by 40% cuts. How are we going to have the kinds of services that we need if we allow that to go ahead? We have got to be loud and campaigning against that, as well as restoring those principles back to our National Health Service that we so strongly believe in. Access to justice. This is, it's Michael Gove, isn't it? It's like, you know, you sort of just despair that, you know, anything that Michael Gove touches just ends up being destroyed. We actually had our greatest successes in Parliament during that brief period when Michael Gove was the chief whip, because he was just so disruptive to his own voting record that we actually managed to achieve a whole series of successful votes against the government. I think I'm really worried about this in the long term. I'm worried about what's happening with probation and where they've gone for those big contracts that don't actually recognise risk and again break up the principles of partnership working. And worried about what it means with their changes and the additional charges they brought in just before the election on justice and so on. We did prioritise, in the work that Sadiq Khan and I were doing, support, for example, for people with domestic violence cases who are not being supported, even though they were supposed to be, under the system the Tories have brought in, and to make that, because that, you know, access to justice there, I think, is hugely important. It has repercussions, not just for people's safety, but for their whole families as well. But I think there's going to need to be, we're going to need to make this a central priority, and it hasn't been. Actually, you know, we've talked about the health service, we've talked about other things that are really important, but I think we're going to have a big national debate about justice and what it means for us as part of standing up not just for access to justice, we've also got to be confident enough to stand up for the Human Rights Act. The Tories want an onslaught against it. We, the Labour Party, should be confident enough to stand up for those basic international as well as British principles around our human rights. Final question about political elites. And look, I think any concentration of power is a bad thing. We should always, as believe in power being and has many, not few, is a principle I've said it a few times, but also that we should always be suspicious of concentrations of power, of not having checks and balances in the system, because that's when power can be abused. Power is in the hands of a narrow Tory elite for year after year after year. That is going to cause huge problems across Britain, and that's why I think we in the Labour Party have a responsibility to be making sure we are strong enough to win the next election, to challenge that Tory elite's concentration of power. Otherwise, we will not be able to defend people across the country. Your questions about defence, I talked about Trident, disarmament. I would like to see multilateral disarmament. I think that's the right approach. We should, of course, have higher standards in terms of abuse of anything, whether it's in the defence or in the arms trade and so on. And, you know, the banking system, to go back to that from the points I was making at the beginning, is, you know, the Tories want to say what started as a banking crisis was instead the public sector's fault. What's the truth? Is that it was only because of the strength of the public sector, the strength of all of us, the strength of governments, that we were able to support the banks and the private sector markets that failed. They want to see it as the other way around, that somehow the fault is in our public services or is in the public sector, and actually the answer is to shrink it back and to just concentrate on a laissez-faire approach to markets instead. What we know is, look, you've got to have much stronger reform of the banking system. You've also got to have then that partnership between businesses and government to create those good new jobs of the future. That's what I believe we should do. But this final question is about how you then have, how do you capture the energy and the anger that people have? I think there is a lot of anger at the moment. We lost the election. A lot of frustration for the fact that the Tories are going to be in power for another 5 years. A lot of energy of young people in particular demanding change, and we have got to change. We've got to shake up the Westminster Old Boys Network. We've got to shake up the power elites. We've got to do things in a different way. We've got to open up our party in a different way so that young people who are coming and joining our party get a stronger voice rather than it all just being centralised. We've got to also, though, make sure we channel that anger to making a difference and to changing the country. If all we do is get angry at the world and we fail to change the world, in the end, we will let people down. And I think we can do both. I think we can capture that anger, that sense of determination to change Britain, and make it happen in practice. Because that's what we did at the beginning. If you think 100 years ago, over 100 years ago, when the Labour Party was formed, we came together and we had Methodist Marxists, we had the cooperative movement, the trade union movement, the Fabian movement, we had so many different branches come together. Actually, we even did a deal with the Liberals, and I would not advocate that. But we did have people come together. Why? Because we were fed up of losing. Because people were fed up of losing votes in Parliament, fed up of losing in the country, fed up of losing in the courts. And actually, we needed to stand together to change Britain. And that's what we have to do now. I think we are, all of us, think it's deeply unjust to have widening inequalities in Britain. It's deeply unjust to have the concentrations of power. It's deeply unjust to have the public services that we depend on being vilified and run down. It's deeply unjust that we don't have the fantastic jobs of the future that other countries do that we could have here in Britain. But if we're going to stand up against that injustice, if we're going to fight against that injustice, if we're not going to just be beaten by the Tories time and time again, we have to be strong enough to reach out, to come together, and to be determined enough to win. And that, I think, is where the final thought I would just leave you with is, you have your ballot paper in front of you, and this is your chance and your choice about what kind of party we're going to be for the next 5 years, about whether we're going to be strong enough to take the Tories on and not let them get away with this, and whether we're going to be strong enough to stand up for all of the people across the country who depend on us. Because in the end, it's not going to be about us. It's not actually even about any of the four candidates, and it's not about any of us here. It's about everybody else that we bumped into in the streets on the way here today. Everybody else that you'll be talking to on Facebook this afternoon. Everybody else in our families, in our communities, that needs a Labour government and that needs us to stand up for them, needs us to stand up for all of us and the kind of country that we believe in. So let's not walk away from that chance. If we didn't have a Labour Party doing all of this, you'd have to invent us. So let's not rip ourselves up now. Let's make sure we can come together. That's why I'm asking for your first preference, because I believe I can be both true to our values and strong enough to take the Tories on and to win. That's what I think we've got to do. We can only do that together. Thank you very much.
Right, can I thank everybody for coming along today. I know it's a Saturday and I know you probably would want to be somewhere else, but I hope that you found Yvette's answers honest, straight to the point, and I hope that you'll certainly consider voting for her, because I certainly would recommend you do that, but you make your own minds up. So once again, thanks very much for coming along. Thank you.
I have an important question.